in here? Is this on, are we on broadcast TV? Because, are we? This isn't being streamed, is it? Is it?
No.
Holy shit, there are a lot of people in here! It's wonderful that everybody is here. This is going to be an absolutely amazing night, because tonight, I remember being at Comic-Con in 2012, when we were the only DC property on television. This fall, we have 5 DC properties on TV. The next 3 hours are going to feature more characters from the DC universe than you have ever seen on any screen. And that is just the tip of the iceberg. Throughout the upcoming television season, these shows are going to explore some of Batman's greatest villains, the dark corners of the supernatural with John Constantine, and the brave and the bold superheroes from the worlds of Flash and Merlin, starring John Barrow. We are halfway through our second episode of season 3 of Arrow, and episode 48. And we are going to show you some footage from that. I know that a lot of people, who was at our panel yesterday? So we're going to show the same trailer, except for 15 seconds of extra footage that you didn't see yesterday.
15 seconds?
15 seconds!
That's not now, that's later. Sorry. Maybe we'll show it twice. Alright, that's not all we got. We're going to be unveiling footage from Constantine, and we are going to screen the full pilots for Gotham and The Flash. My colleagues, are you ready to get this started? Right. To help me do that, I'd like to... Oh my God, what is happening? Alright, to do that, I would like to introduce a friend of mine. He's going to tell us about the first show of the night. Everybody, please give a very lovely Hall H welcome to Barry Allen himself, Mr. Matt Gustin. Excuse me?
No.
I have a text from Grant. Sorry. Steven, you might want to cover your ears because this is going to be a little bit loud.
Well, if you haven't seen it, and even if you have, because we know some of you have, haven't seen it like this on this screen with all of us in the biggest hall at Comic-Con. Right.
Obviously, you wouldn't totally be here if you hadn't appeared on Arrow last season.
Yeah.
So, crossovers between the Arrow and Flash. We're gonna do those, right? We should do those, right?
Hell yes. So, keep an eye out for a familiar face in the Flash pilot. And coming up this season on The Flash, it's already been announced, we're going to have Firestorm. He'll be appearing. Ronnie Raymond, be played by a great actor who you may know, Robbie Amell. And this year, we will also meet the Rogues, led by Captain Cold, who will be played by Wentworth Miller. And also get ready for Reverse Flash.
Alright, this is just the start of the night. What do you think, guys? Should we show the pilot now?
Let's do it.
Alright, everybody, enjoy The Flash. We're gonna do lots of crossovers, but if you ever want to see Oliver Queen and Commissioner Gordon on the same stage together, and you should get your cell phones ready. Ladies and gentlemen, the star of Gotham, Jim Gordon himself, Ben McKenzie.
Thank you, Stephen. Oh my God, this is crazy. This is crazy. I am so excited to be here to help present the world premiere of Gotham. Gotham begins with a story that all of you know, the murders of Thomas and Martha Wayne, which leave a young Bruce orphaned and alone. That moment changes Gotham forever. Throughout the series, you're going to see the origins of some of the most famous supervillains, not to mention a certain police detective, in comic book history. You're gonna see the Catwoman, Riddler, Penguin. They're all there, and you know, if you watch closely, there might be a few others. So we're really excited for you guys to see it.
Logue Gotham pilot, here we go! Now it is time for DC's Supernatural. Constantine, favorite con man and mine, is going to open the door to the dark cult and horrific corner of the DC Universe. And now it's time to meet John Constantine himself. Here is the star of Constantine, Mr. Matt Ryan.
Well, thank you, Stephen, and hey, everyone, how's it going? So I'm Matt Ryan, and as you probably know, they did cast Brit as John Constantine, right? So pretty cool. As many of you know in this room, that Constantine is inspired by the Hellblazer comics and the Constantine comics. And we'll be introducing several characters from the comic books throughout the upcoming season. Zed from Hellblazer will be joining the show, and which is awesome. And also a cop called Jim Corrigan. Yeah, he'll be joining, and the Spectre will probably won't be far behind that. So keep your eyes open and the lights on. Yeah, now we've got a lot in store for you this season, so enough talking for me anyway. I've been told that we can't show the full screening of the pilot, but we do have a kick-ass preview, so take a look.
Armor this year, we have Brandon Routh, which is super. Also, Katana, another pretty major supervillain from the DC Universe, will be dropping in to wreak havoc. See if you can spot... Oh, also, the thing that I was talking about earlier, the extra little 15 seconds, our big villain, see if you can spot him in this sneak peek. This year is going to be unreal. So, let's get to the panel. For the panel, I'm going to turn over my Master of Ceremonies duties and bring out our moderator. It's my great pleasure to welcome an acclaimed and highly successful comic writer and graphic novelist, who is also the co-writer of the Flash pilot that you and I just saw tonight. And in his spare time, he's the chief creative officer of DC Entertainment. Please welcome my good friend, Jeff Johns.
I'm really happy to say we have the most people we've ever had on stage in Hall H. This is a world record. We're going to bring out the entire cast of all these shows and the producers. So we start with... Oh, Tigers. So we'll start with Arrow. Continue with, from Steven, Katie Cassidy. David Ramsey. Guggenheim. And Andrew Kreisberg. And from The Flash, we've got Grant Gustin. Candice Patton. Jesse L. Martin. Tom Cavanaugh. Danielle Panabaker. The original Flash, John Wesley Shipp. From Constantine, John Gotham himself, Matt Ryan. Carol Perno. Charles Helfert. Ahelika Sayer. Producers Daniel Cerrone. And David Goyer. From Gotham, look at all these people. See, this is what happens when we have so many people. World record. It is a record,
yeah. Yeah, we're gonna talk again this tomorrow.
Gotham, we got Ben McKenzie. Donal, Logue. Jada Pinkett Smith. Robin Lord Taylor. Erin Richards. Mazouz, Camren Bicondova, and creator Bruno Heller, and director Danny Cannon. It's amazing to see everybody here from DC Television tonight. It's kind of crazy to have the universe represented like this. So I'm going to ask some questions for a bit, and then we're going to throw over to you guys and get some questions from the audience. I'm going to start with some Gotham questions. So Bruno, I'll start with you. And Danny, so Gotham, where did this all come from? Why start with the death of the Waynes? Where did you spark that idea? Thanks, John.
Origin stories are my favorite part of the mythology of the DC universe, and origin stories in general. When I started talking with Jeff about doing something in the DC universe, it was just natural to me to start thinking from the start of the process and what is more sort of iconic and seminal than the death of the Waynes. And then it was really, the nut of the idea was putting young detective Gordon in that crime scene as the detective who investigates the case. That was the beginning of the thing, and everything followed from there. It just grew. It's a common mythology that we all share, so it wasn't really my idea, it's everybody's idea, that kind of we're just presenting it in a way.
And Danny, where'd you get what was your inspiration for the vision of the show? It's so spectacular. It's just a beautiful, majestic cinematic show. Where did you, what did you draw from the lore?
It was a dream come true, as far as the director's concerned. And sitting down with Bruno, I couldn't believe we haven't worked together before. We're both in similar places in London, but it was weird. The first 5 minutes of that meeting was everything that was there tonight. It was a dream of Gotham, a city that I always wished I could have visited as a kid. The comic books I read, the movies that I saw, we just had to go back in time and imagine what that decrepit, decaying, corrupt city was like from the very beginning. And I just started sketching, and it went from there.
And Ben, so you're like the only good cop in Gotham right now. And Donald, you're a pretty bad cop in Gotham, but are you going to drag Gordon down, or is Gordon going to pick you up?
I think we're going to meet in the middle, probably,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, Harvey's, like, Harvey knows how the city works, and Jim believes he knows how the city ought to work. And between those two worlds is Gotham.
It's hard not to love Ben, so it's...
Ooh, wow, hey, all right.
Such a do-gooder, he kind of pulls him to a little bit of the other side of the equation.
Yeah, yeah. Donal and I feel like we've known each other forever. I worked with his sister on Southland. She played a hooker. I had her by the throat in an alley in downtown Los Angeles. So I feel like we really know each other well. So.
She said, what a nice guy you are.
Yeah. She was playing the part. She was great. And the Logues are in it to win it, man. They do it right.
So speaking of the cops, we'll go to the villains, Jada. So you're one of the most charismatic people on screen. And in this, you bring a real seductive quality, like you do right now, to everything. So what's it like playing this villain who Bruno, you created this brand new character, so you can really do whatever you want? We don't know what the outcome of this character is. What's that like?
It's a very unique experience. And, you know, to be part of a franchise like this and have the opportunity to collaborate with someone like Bruno, Danny, to create this character, it's just been amazing.
Robin, so everyone has saw the Penguin. I think this is the most brilliant representation of the Penguin. Like, it's really, and I've read the scripts that Bruno and his crew are doing, and it's extremely twisted. Thanks Fox for letting us get away with that. What's your inspiration for Oswald Cobblepot? Because this is a very different Penguin than I think anyone's ever seen.
I would say, all I can say is that, you know, as an actor, you just want to get the best material possible. And when I come to set and we look at what we're doing for the day, and I see what's been written, I see what's been created, and it's all just there in front of me, I feel like I'm just stepping into something amazing. I feel like it's a vessel that I'm filling, you know? And it, for, you know, inspiration, I don't know. It's just a drinking trip. I don't know.
How much makeup? How much makeup is on
there? There's a lot of makeup on me. Like, it's a lot. I mean, you wouldn't think so. It's very subtle, and I actually really like that. I mean, you know, not to say that I'm not doing anything, but like, you know, once they put all this stuff on, I feel like half my work is done. Like, I just feel like all the pieces come together, and it's just, you know, we're there, you know.
Okay, so David, little Bruce Wayne. So, first off, we were saying how jealous your friends are that you get to be a Batman in training. How old do you think you're going to have to be before you put on that costume?
Well, that's kind of up to Bruno and Danny. I think Batman becomes Batman when he's 25. I think so. So hopefully this show will run until I'm 25. Fingers crossed.
And Carmen, Camren, so you're brilliant, Celine. You're like a little Michelle Pfeiffer, so cute. You guys are both really young, so where did you first get introduced to Catwoman, and did you know the character prior to this, and what did you look to for research?
Well, I looked to the comics and the Batman show with Adam West for research. I saw some of those too, but other than that, most of the show and the comics. Yeah. I actually didn't know that I was auditioning for Selena Kyle. I thought I was auditioning for a girl named Lucy. So, you know, yeah. And what was the other part of the question?
Well, what are you most excited about with Selena?
Oh, I'm excited about everything. She's really mysterious, and you don't really know what she's thinking all the time, or whether she's thinking anything at all. You know, she's cat lover, I'm a cat lover. I feel like we could be best friends, you know? So, yeah.
To go back to the man who kind of started this all, the Potter cake, Stephen Amell. We really wish with Greg and Andrew and Mark created Arrow and kicked off what made this all possible. So thank you so much for that, guys. So Steve and like Mr. Al Ghul, that's cool. You guys like that? That's gonna be awesome. So tell them a little bit about season three and what's in store for all of them.
So season three for all of our characters is really about identity, and it's, can Oliver be Oliver Queen and be the Arrow? Can he do both at the same time? Does he have to pick? And we're presented with a bunch of scenarios in the pilot, in the premiere, that forces him to make a decision. And season three is really going to be about that journey. I'm excited for it. I'm excited. It's Arrow with a little bit more green.
That's good. Greg, I know you're a massive fan along with Andrew and Mark, and you guys have done such a tremendous job on this on behalf of fans. Thank you for loving the material as much as I do. Really amazing. How you guys embrace the show, and you know it's great because Warner Brothers Television, the president Peter Roth loves comic books. He's kind of a nerd. Sorry, Peter. But he's really embraced all this stuff, and that's why this is happening with his team. And you guys started this off with Arrow. When you were first thinking about Arrow, Greg, did you think that you would build a show this big and spin off something like The Flash? And what was that process like for you, creating this universe?
Well, first, I just want to say, I think on behalf of so many people here, thank you guys for coming out tonight. It's past my bedtime. I hope it's past your bedtime. I especially want to thank this little gentleman in the front row who I think is falling asleep. I feel bad for him. We were so excited upstairs because I think so many of us love the characters and love these worlds as much as you do, and we really do. Go to work every day and pinch ourselves. I mean, we started just with the hope to do to make an Arrow show that we would want to watch, and that's sort of been our commitment throughout. And it really has grown beyond our wildest dreams. And we just keep following our own passion. We take our lead from everybody else's passion and the fans' passion, and that keeps us inspired. And certainly everything that's happening up in Vancouver. And the production and the actors and everyone behind the scenes. Every time we get a cut, we watch it the way you guys, I think, watch a new episode of the shows. And so we've just sort of followed that trail, and we've been really, really blessed and fortunate that along the way, we've just had all the support in the world from the studio, from the network, and from all of you. So it's been a dream.
Mark, I know you're a big nerd too. So can you tell us a little bit about some more of the characters from the DC Universe that will be showing up this season on Arrow?
Yeah, we've got Tatsu Yoshiro, who is, everyone knows, becomes Katana. We've got Brandon Routh playing Ray Palmer, who everyone knows becomes the Atom. We've got a little guy named Ra's al Ghul, who we've been hearing about for a couple of years. We're finally going to get a chance to see him in the flesh. And there'll be one other DC character who we haven't announced yet.
Can you or not?
What? Are you Ted Grant. Wow. Coming aboard the show. And going to have a little interaction with Laurel. Let's just say that.
Okay, so you forgot one. We saw this image was released, I think, last week. Arsenal, Colton Haynes. So, Colton, what's it feel like to join the ranks of the costume superheroes?
It's freaking awesome. I mean, you can't really, until you guys see this costume in its entirety, it's the coolest costume in the world. They gave me a butt. Like, I have a really nice butt in the costume, so I'm really excited about it. But really, it's just really cool to, join Team Arrow and to be part of such a great team, feels like a family.
And so Black Canary, Katie and Katie.
Oh, there's my cup. Where's Katie? Oh.
Hold on.
Hi. Oh, she has one. Okay.
So what's this about Ted Dran, who is a boxing champion? Why would he be messing with you?
I don't know. Did you read the comic books?
I have read the comic books.
Wildcat? I don't know.
And Ms. Watts, how is it to play? Your Black Mary is such a badass.
She's pretty cool, right?
She is pretty cool.
She's badass.
So I know that the character's coming back. Can you say anything about how it's been to play Black Canary and what you were inspired by for this character? She's so wounded and tortured.
Yeah. Well, of course I read some Birds of Prey comics and the Black Canary comics, which of course are written by our wonderful writers over here. And mostly I just took it from, you know, like she has a really dark past. And I think that makes her character so strong, but she's so vulnerable with her connection with her family and stuff. So it's been fun. And getting to wear that costume is like, I mean, come on, it's pretty fun.
We like when you wear that costume.
Well, thank you.
John, so Dark Archer. Malcolm Merlyn, we saw him return, surprisingly. What's his plan this season? He's a villain, but he's got this strange heroic quality too. So in your mind, who is this guy?
In my eyes, if I'm speaking from Malcolm himself, I'm as much a hero as Oliver Queen is, actually. That's the way I see it. And, what's really going to be exciting is who he's going to face up to this season, what is going to happen, the whole relationship between Malcolm and his daughter, Thea, and what's going to happen, and how it's going to be the most amazing, the most fantastically dysfunctional father-daughter relationship on television ever. And I cannot wait to get my teeth into it. It's going to be awesome, yeah.
And are you going to teach Willa how to shoot a arrow?
You're just going to have to watch. You never know. I'll teach her a few things. Yeah. Yeah.
I'm really scared right now, guys.
Don't be, darling. I'll take care of you.
All right. I'm gonna transition a little over to Flash, and I'm gonna use it with Emily. Well, Emily. So, yes. Tell us the definitive answer. Is it going to be Oliver and Felicity, or is it going to be Barry and Felicity?
Whoa. What about Ray Palmer? We just talked, and he's a man, too. We had... No, he's hot. Let me backtrack. Gosh, I work with these guys every day. This is real bad. We have Barry's intellect and Oliver's intellect. I'm just digging myself a hole. This is where Felicity and I sort of, this is where we zone because I like.
This is where you're exactly really. Like Felicity.
I don't know. I am very lucky that I get to transition over to The Flash and in episodes to come. We can all look forward to such. I'm very, very excited. I don't even have to leave the lot to do, which is great. It'll be really, really fun. But I am not sure. In terms of love interest, I don't know. Are they interested in Felicity at a certain point? Who knows? I mean, it's all going to change. We deal with life and death every day. When it comes, I'm serious, we do. Every day.
So on the brighter side.
On the brighter side of life.
Of love. Andrew, I know you're like, it's so funny because your arrows can be so dark, and yet you're the guy that walks around with a smile on his face all the time, and you constantly pitch jokes. Because for Flash, I think the heart of it is really something that you helped bring out, obviously, it's from you, and you really got your hands into Felicity as a character and created that voice with Greg and everyone else, but where do you, why so much humor in the Flash? Why change that when you develop?
First of all, we were just very conscious of not wanting to make the same show twice, and we assumed you guys didn't want to watch two hours of the same show every week, and so whereas Arrow has a much darker quality to it, with Flash, we wanted to do something a little lighter, a little brighter, a little bit more blue sky, and Barry Allen has always sort of had that. If you read the comics, he's always been a lighter character, and there's always been a lot more humor, so we were just really excited to explore that aspect of it. And of course I walk around with a smile on my face. Oliver Queen, Barry Allen, Bruce Wayne, John Constantine. I mean, this is ridiculous.
So Grant, there is obviously some darkness and tragedy we saw in The Flash's past and in that pilot, and yet you bring such a joy and optimism to the character. He's got a hopeful outlook. Where do you find that balance for you when you're playing Barry Allen? Like, what do you draw from for that?
God, I mean, I love Barry. I love him. And he's full of hope, he's full of optimism, which is the part that I can definitely relate to. I try to be optimistic in my life. I think we'd go crazy with this career if we aren't optimistic. So that's something I can draw from. And as far as the emotional depth of the character, I mean, that's what my favorite part of being an actor is, just digging as deep as I can. I mean, that's when I have the most fun, is just kind of the emotional rawness of the character. So, I mean, I love that there's both sides to it. He's an idiot, he's a dork, and it's hilarious, but he's brilliant, and there's a lot of depth to him, and it's just, he's a very genuine character that I love playing, and I think that's why he's easy to relate to, because he's just so genuine.
And you know, he's in this too, you play off Jesse so well, that relationship between Barry and Detective Joe West. So great. So Jesse, I know that like superheroes probably wasn't the first thing you think you'd do next after everything else you've done. Why did you say yes to Flash? How did that happen?
Well, I obviously played a detective before. But when I met Andrew and Greg in New York, they sat down and they pitched to me like two puppies that had to pee and couldn't go outside. And they were so excited about the whole thing, and they saw me fitting in way more than I saw myself fitting in, that I was like, I'd be stupid not to consider this at least. And I said, well, let me just read something. And when I read it, I was like, this is absolutely amazing, and I have to do it. And as long as I played the detective, I never got to shoot anything. And we're only in the beginning of things, and I didn't shot a lot of people. So, it's a good thing. Not that you should go out shooting people. But if you become an actor and you get a job and they give you a gun, you get to shoot a whole lot of metahumans. Just saying.
So the other father figure, we're really bad here on the show, Jess. You know what I mean? The other father figure who's an actor who played The Flash before, John Musashev. Amazing actor. We were talking earlier, like, there was no Comic-Con like it is now when The Flash TV show was originally on. So this is pretty different, I assume, from your experience the first time around.
Yeah, we shot till 9 a.m. one Saturday morning, and they said, down to San Diego, and I think we walked through a convention hall and signed a few autographs and took a few pictures, and the whole thing took about 2 hours. This is very different.
And what made you say yes coming back to The Flash to revisit this?
In the wild and wacky world of superheroes, 24 years is a long time to represent. And I just say, in my experience, I can't be more delighted and more grateful to have the opportunity to return to the project and to pass it off to such a fine actor and new friend and colleague.
Very gracious. So Tom, what's the deal, man? You stepped up out of that wheelchair.
You tell me, Jeff. You tell me, Jeff Johns, what is the deal?
What is the deal? So what's Dr. Wells' interest in The Flash? Can you delve into that a little bit? Why is he, how's he know all this stuff?
Yeah. You heard Kreisberg, right? Say nothing. This is like, yeah, I'm caught in a tough place. I will say that sometimes, Jeff, in the comic book world, people are not always exactly what they appear to be.
I've heard that.
Yeah, that happens occasionally. And this might be one of those instances. Certainly, Barry has three mentor figures. He's got his real father, played by John, Jesse, the man who brought him up, and then once he gets struck by lightning, he's got a guy who has a vested interest. I play that guy, and you know more than me, so quit asking me the questions.
Sorry, I had to torture you a little bit.
Understood. You owe me, though.
Candice, we know where your character's going, obviously, coming up in Flash, but you know the character from the comic books. She's a reporter. So where is Iris going to go, and how is her relationship with Barry going to stay the same, change?
Well, what I love about Iris is, something that we all look for in our lives. We're always looking for that person who's kind of our true north and our best friend. And I think Iris is that for Barry, and that's fun to play. But I think it's going to be interesting to see how their relationship evolves once he's got these superpowers and she learns that not only is Barry her best friend and her father keeping the secret from her, how she deals with that family dynamic and how that changes her relationship with not only her father, but someone that she's considered her best friend her entire life. It's gonna be a little tricky. It's exciting because, yeah, that's gonna happen. I'm at Comic-Con, guys.
You just realized that. You've been here 3 days.
Oh my God. Thanks for inviting me.
So, David, where's Mr. Goyer? Hey, David. So you guys know David, he wrote all those kick-ass Batman movies. Man of Steel. He made the first good Marvel movie with Blade. So David, I know when you sat down and talked to everybody about what you wanted to do in television, you had your choice of basically anything you could do. So after Batman and Superman, why John?
Well, he's probably actually one of my favorite comic book characters of all time, and I actually have a letter written in the letters pages of one of the Swamp Things when Constantine was first introduced, when Alan Moore was writing him, theorizing about what the darkness was. And so it's pretty crazy to be up here so many years later, and Jeff and I, you and I were writing comic books 15 years ago, and now look at this is just insane.
Yeah.
But why Constantine? He doesn't have any spandex, which is kind of nice, doesn't have any superpowers, and we joke that, like, if he, you know, first he'll try to throw a spell, and if that doesn't work, he might try to pick a fight, and if that doesn't work, he might try to do a con. If that doesn't work, he'll try to kick the guy in the balls, and if that doesn't work, he'll just run, and that's like a fun character to write after all this time.
Yeah, very different than Superman.
Yeah.
So Daniel, when you guys were casting the show, What made you land on Matt Ryan, who's tremendous and he's Constantine in body, but how did you know that you had found him?
You know, I have to say that I don't know if an actor has ever worked harder for Orange Bat. I don't know if an actor has ever worked harder for this role than Matt Ryan did, because we cast such a wide net and we interviewed actors from, it was very important to have a Brit, it was very important to have an accent. It's interesting because we looked at Australians and some different territories, like, okay, they can fake a Brit accent.
A couple Kiwis.
We didn't look at American actors to do a British accent, but we got tapes from everywhere. We auditioned actors in Los Angeles. We got one self-tape in from this guy who's worked with Jude Law and Henry V, And you should have seen the tape we had. First of all, he was about 10 pounds lighter than he is now. He had dark hair, long, slicked back, completely to his skull. And he had a beard. And he looked like Sasquatch. Why? And it was
David
actually. He looked like a Hasidic Jew.
$6 million man Sasquatch.
But here's the thing. I mean, and I don't know if it's a Shakespearean training. I don't know what it is. But he said the lines, and you could see it in his eyes, and you could see it in the way he owned it. He looked nothing like this now, but it was like, this is John Constantine. And it took us multiple rounds, like until he literally was done off stage and he got on a plane on, what was it, a Friday maybe, when your like play ended?
Yeah, we like finished on the Saturday night. I went out and got drunk, jumped on a plane, flew over, cut all my hair off, shaved my beard, and walked in a room on the
And we trotted him in and we're like, this is the guy, you can see him now. Like, you don't have to use your imagination anymore, this is it. And as soon as everybody did see him, it was a done deal.
And Matt, what kind of research did you do for this character? Because this character is very unique, obviously, and you embody him perfectly. So what did you do to get there?
I read as many comics as possible. I mean, what's funny about it is I see the movie, and I have a friend of mine who's a huge comic book fan, and he'd been talking to me years about John Constantine and the Hellblazer comics, and just kind of been in the background for years and years. And then when the audition came up, he sat me down and he was like, this is how John Constantine's got to be, you know, it's got to be like this, it's got to be like this. And I was like, okay, all right, you know, let me just do the audition. And so I read one comic, and then just carried on delving deeper and deeper. And after I got the role, I just kind of gleaned as much as I could from the comics, and I'm still reading them. I mean, there's a lot to get through, so I'm still reading and still searching and still trying to get under John's flesh. And yeah.
There are any other DC characters? I know the answer, but I'd love to hear from you. Any other DC characters going to show up in the series?
Yeah, I think there are. Right, there's Jim Corrigan.
Corrigan, and obviously he turns into the Spectre.
Yep.
Helmet of Dr. Fate shows up in the pilot, so...
Yeah, there's lots of Easter eggs in that, and we've obviously got Zed, played by the beautiful...
Papa Midnight's showing up in a few episodes. We'll be rolling out a number.
Cool. Well, I'm going to open up to fan questions. I don't know where the mic is, but we can take a few questions. We don't have a lot of time, but we'll take a few questions. So if anybody's got a question, there's... Hey, what's your name?
Name's Alwyn.
Hey, Alwyn.
San Diego.
Cool.
I can just take a... Sure.
Yeah, you guys should all take pictures. But maybe ask your question first.
Yeah. My question's for Stephen Emile and the creators of Arrow. And first off, I want to thank you for making the show available on Wednesday nights on Hulu, because I don't have cable. I don't have to wait till Thursday, so I appreciate that.
That was my idea.
My question is something you touched upon during the panel last night, about how the Green Arrow character is kind of a little more sarcastic in the comic book, in the cartoon. Is that kind of personality going to come out more, and as he becomes the Green Arrow altogether?
Yeah, we never even used the word arrow in the first season, and then as we moved to the second season, and he was the Hood, was the vigilante. And then in the second season, we started saying Arrow, the Arrow. And the idea has always been that this series and this journey that you're seeing Oliver Queen go on is really his journey to becoming the Green Arrow. Because we want to have a character that evolves. If we're not, if we're looking at a finished product, then that to me is not interesting. So the idea would be to take the character to a spot where eventually he's the Green Arrow. And I hope that happens.
Thank you. Next.
Hi.
Hi. What's your name?
Hey.
Hey.
So the Flash was my favorite superhero. So I'm really excited to see him on TV, not just comics all the time now. But a large part of him being my favorite is because the Rogues Gallery is like the most ridiculous and awesome series of villains I can think of. And I saw that Clyde Martin was introduced as Weather Wizard for the series, so is this one supposed to be? And I was curious if his brother Mark or might make an appearance, or why the decision to make him appear as Weather Wizard initially as a concept, or if we might see other rogues join Captain Cold at some point in the series.
We wanted to have one of his most iconic villains in the pilot, so but we also knew that we wanted Jesse to shoot him. Fortunately in the comics, Mark Martin has a brother, Clyde, so somebody was obviously flying the plane that we saw Clyde Martin jump into, so there is another Weather Wizard out there, and we will see him one day. We were very conscious of, we weren't just doing a show about the Flash, we were doing a show about the Flash and everyone in that comic book, and Central City, and Iris, and Joe, and, and all the villains, because the rogues, especially all the work that our very handsome moderator tonight, Jeff Johns, has done in comics, over the last 15 years, in building up the rogues gallery. So we're very blessed. Wentworth Miller is going to be playing Captain Cold in episode 4, which will also be the first appearance of Felicity on The Flash. The others will they'll get rolled out one by one.
You will get a glimpse of another one in episode.
That's true.
Yeah, and you will see Grodd. That cage was not there by mistake. We heard you guys. Next, please. Maybe.
What's up, y'all?
Hey. What's your name?
My Nick, by the way. My question's for the Arrow Riders. So now since John Barrowman's back, do you guys think at some point down the line in season 3 that we're going to see the Arrow and John Barrowman team up against Ra's al Ghul?
I think that, we've established firmly that Ra's al Ghul hates Merlin, and Oliver doesn't like Merlin, and so I think it's going to be a series of, who hates who more, and, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, so, a lot of the work that we've been doing, Mark and Greg, over the last few years, we've basically been building up to this, and, a lot of the voices that you heard when we showed Ra's al Ghul were just clips of dialogue from specific episodes and talking about him and mentioning him. So, as much as this season is about identity, as Steven mentioned, a lot of it is about allegiance and loyalty. And, a war is coming, and, what side are you going to take is going to be a question that all the characters are going to have to face.
I'm so not frightened.
Thanks. Hey, Wally.
Hey, guys.
That's really weird.
Hi.
How's it going? Gotta put this up to my face. Okay. So, anyway, I noticed in The Flash, you had Ferris Airways. And in Arrow, even though it was for a split second, there was a Blue Devil. Billboard. I was wondering, are these little Easter eggs, or maybe say someone like Green Lantern might show up later in the series?
We never say never.
Yeah, the Ferris Air was actually Jeff's idea. Usually that's the kind of thing that Greg or Mark or I'll come up with, and Jeff will be like, you can't do that. And on that one, he's like, oh yeah, we're doing that. The Blue Devil movie will also make an appearance on Flash. We've been really blessed, with DC Comics. They've been really open about letting us dip into their roster of characters. And there are very few characters that we've sort of asked to use that they put the kibosh on. So, hopefully, these little Easter eggs that get thrown out there, will pay off in the future.
So is Green Lantern going to appear?
No, Steven, see, I just kept talking and talking so that maybe everyone would forget that I got asked that question.
Good question. Next.
Hey everyone, my name's Leonard.
Hey Leonard.
There's a question I've been dying to ask Stephen and Mel, and it's about that amazing salmon ladder exercise we've seen you do on the show.
I'm not the only one up here that's done it. Katie Lotz did the salmon ladder last year. It took her a while, but she did it.
Anyway, my question is, after you get up to that top rung, how do you safely get yourself and that bar down from that height? And have you ever gotten injured, I guess it's for both of you, while you were learning how to do it?
Never got injured. And, you know, I like to be very forthcoming when it comes to explaining the show. But the mystery of how the salmon ladder bar comes down will never, ever be answered. Sorry.
Thanks. Hey, man.
Hey.
Thanks for staying up late.
My pleasure.
What's your name? What's that?
Connor.
Hey, Connor. What's your question?
Whoa, I'm huge. Sorry. my question is for Stephen Grant. How does it feel to step into such an iconic superhero shoe, to become the Flash, to become the Green Arrow?
That's a great question, Connor. The coolest experience that I've ever had in our 2+ seasons of shooting was when I was in the Flash pilot, because it was David Nutter who directed our pilot. It was Glenn Winter, who's in the audience tonight and was our director of photography on both. And directed some of the best of things. Hey, Glenn, I can see you. Hey, Glenn. Big tall guy, red shirt. To go back and to actually, I mean, I haven't even played a scene yet with Grant when he's in the costume, but the idea of interacting with such an iconic member of the DC universe, I mean, that was a highlight for me. So the experience has been good so far. I can't speak for Grant, so I'll let him say his piece.
Yeah, for me, this is like completely, completely surreal. I grew up loving this genre of, like, I wasn't a comic book fan necessarily growing up, but I was a huge fan of the Christopher Reeve Superman franchise and all those movies. But I also grew up doing musical theater and like tap dancing and in Virginia. So I mean, this is not only something that it's not a dream come true. It's something I could have never fathomed. And when I got to put the suit on for the first time, it blew my mind. That's me right there, and it's nuts. It's insane. It's I'm having the time of my life. So it's incredible.
Thanks, Connor.
Thank you. Hey man, what's your name?
I'm Connor's dad.
Oh, hey, Connor's dad.
He was also the kid that was in the Green Lantern movie panel a few years ago that asked that awesome question from Ryan Reynolds.
Good kid.
Yeah, I'm pretty darn proud. We talked about how Flash and Arrow are in the same cinematic universe. Are Gotham and Constantine potentially going to be in that same universe, or are we keeping those completely separate?
Well, Gotham kind of takes, Brody, you can talk about that a little bit. It kind of takes place kind of in the past, but also in the present.
Yeah, that's a good question. Again, I would say never say never. I think at the moment, both shows are new, and one of the things about creating a TV show is you're trying to create and find the tone of the show. And if those two worlds, if there's those two DC worlds, coincide, then it would work. But as you say, I'm not really clear about the chronology with how Constantine interacts. Maybe Constantine is only 5 or something in this universe, and that wouldn't be very entertaining. But yeah,
or what is
they never? Yeah, you could come up with a story over there. Time travel. There you go.
That'll fit right in with Gotham.
All right, we'll work on that.
Thanks.
Hey guys.
Hey.
So this is a question for Grant, Steven, and John Constantine, Mark. If Flash, Arrow, and Constantine got into a fight, who'd win?
I would run away really fast because I don't want to fight Arrow, that's for sure.
this point.
I mean, what do you expect me to say? I would win. Yeah. Choose your words carefully, okay? Yeah. Okay.
Hey, buddy.
Actually, our episode 8 this year, Flash, is called Flash versus Arrow. So you'll be able to find out, I think.
Hi.
Hey.
I'm Morrow.
I'm Morrow.
And my question is for Grant and Emily. My question is, why did you choose to play this character? Like, what resonates with you most about this character? Because these two characters have absolutely stolen my heart over the past, like, ever. And I just really want to, like, commend both of you for, like, your incredible acting.
Thank you.
Really great.
She stole my heart too. I feel very fortunate and proud to play such an intelligent, well-written woman on television. And I'm so grateful every day. She has a really special place in my heart, and I'm really glad that she resonated with you and anyone else.
Yeah, and I don't know if I could express any more how much I love playing this character. So, I mean, it's just, everything resonates with me. Every day I love this character more. Every script I get, I love this character more. He just has a lot of heart, and I just love playing the character.
Thank you. Hey, man. Hey, my name is Edward. This is actually a question for Stephen Amell. My best friend, Danielle, has you on her list of three. Yeah. No, I'm not going to ask that
there,
one.
There are kids here.
Yeah,
okay.
No, I'm going to ask that one.
The answer is yes, you will. Yes, you will, let's talk after. I'll work out a deal for you.
Awesome. Well, and to be clear, there are just two on the list of three. It's you and Channing Tatum, and you're higher. So.
I feel like this whole weekend is a success now.
So my question is actually a follow-up to something you answered at Dallas Comic-Con.
Sure.
And this is, now that you're in filming shape, fighting shape for the entire season, which you felt you weren't at Dallas Comic-Con, you kind of punted on this question. This is on behalf of Danielle, thousands of women in Hall H, and John Barrowman.
Do not take it off. I will kill you.
Take it off.
There are kids here.
There are kids here.
Old kids would love to see
voice
your ass.
Yeah, I'm still gonna say no. Tune in on Wednesday
night. I think the panel should vote. I'm up for it. Let's go.
Wednesday nights. All right, that we cannot top that question. So, I had a question, Matt, for you. Two questions. One is, how is it you and Harold? What is that relationship like between you and Manny on Constantine? Is that, you know, you play an angel, is that a relationship that we'll see, is an antagonistic relationship? Is it a friendship? What is that gonna be?
At the moment, I'm just trying to get his abs out of my mind. It's like, whoa.
That's tough to follow that.
No, what's weird about the relationship between us both is that he's kind of, they're both manipulators and they both try to take advantage of each other, but there's also a mutual respect between us both. So we're both kind of, I don't know, you said a great thing, didn't you, about the
They're both sort of like, you know, when they approach each other, they're like gunslingers. Mm. You know, they're always sort of have one hand on the hip and, you know, about to shoot, but, you know, they both have a lot of respect for each other. So it's antagonistic, but it'll go through many different stages because, look, you can only be antagonistic with John Constantine. That's all you can have. But if you're trying to push him, you can find other colors and other things that will come out in the relationship.
Yeah, he inspires that in everybody.
And Matt, how excited are you for this fall when these people can see the full pilot?
But why can't we see the full pilot tonight? I mean, I've seen all the other pilots, right?
We saw Gotham and Flash. You guys want to stick around and watch Constantine? All right, we're gonna roll Constantine after, but give it up for DC Television, the Star Trek.